We are back on the Zero Hour. I am your host, Richard RJ Eskow. With the start of the Biden administration and Democrats now in control of the House and Senate, but by a slim margin in the Senate and a slimmer margin in the House, there's a lot of talk about what can and cannot be done in the area of healthcare. And as a longtime advocate for Medicare for All, I'm looking forward to talking to my next guest about that because he is co-author of a new book on the subject. Dr. Abdul Al-Sayed is a physician. He is an epidemiologist. He's a progressive activist. He's an educator. He's the author of a previous book. And he has a podcast on Crooked Media called America Dissected. His new book is entitled Medicare for All, A Citizen's Guide, which is available for pre-order and will come out on February 1st. So first of all, Abdul Al-Sayed, thank you for coming back on the program.
RJ, thank you so much for having me to talk about this critical subject that has become even more critical in the context of this pandemic.
I couldn't agree more. So we're starting off on a great note here. As you and I know, writing a book, it doesn't happen overnight. So I would imagine that you and Dr. Johnson have been working on this for some time. The title is Medicare for All, A Citizen's Guide. I would also guess that by the time you started writing it or when you were well into it, it already became clear what the political outlines and the Democratic Party were going to be. But let's start with this. What were your motivations for writing this book?
Well, I'll tell you what. We started writing this about 2.5 years ago. You're right, RJ. Books don't happen overnight. But we knew that there just weren't very many accessible guides to Medicare for All. And what we wanted to do was cut through a lot of the political mumbo jumbo and a lot of the jargon that gets used to talk about healthcare to write a clear, comprehensive, and concise guide that anybody could use and pick up to understand what Medicare for All is, what the proposals look like, how it maps to the challenges that we face in our healthcare right now, what the politics of Medicare for All look like, and what it means to get there. And stepping back, you're right. We realized that before this book would come out, that the political winds weren't going to be blowing in the direction of having a administration that was supportive of Medicare for All. At the same time, though, we've got to remember where we're headed. Any tinkering at the edges of the current healthcare system as it stands aren't really going to solve the deep and severe structural challenges in our current healthcare system. And so we wanted this guide, hopefully, to reignite a conversation about where we need to go over the long term and remind people that whether it's in this administration or a future administration, that we need to keep our eyes on the prize and we need to keep marching forward to understand what the problems in our healthcare are, how Medicare for All would help to solve them, and what it will take for us to win it once and for all for the people of these United States of America.
Well, let's take each of those in turn, because I think that's a great summary. So let's start with what the, and obviously, you know, we only have give or take a half hour or a little less. So our problems are so profound and severe and complex. We're only going to scratch the surface, but given with that proviso, like broadly, what are the problems? How would you describe them?
Yeah, there are a number. And they start with the structure of our healthcare system. The fact that we have a private health insurance system that leaves 900 health insurers all seeking a profit motive, in effect, to be middlemen of healthcare, creates a number of issues. Number one, it's too expensive and it's getting more expensive every single day. Those health insurers don't have an incentive to reduce the cost of healthcare simply because they're a lot more interested in whether or not they're able to win reimbursement rates that are good for their bottom line. And they pass off the cost of healthcare back onto patients in what we call a deductible, right? So you pay for healthcare or your employer pays for healthcare if you're lucky enough to have it every 2 weeks or every month. That's called a premium. And then there's this deductible, which is basically a paywall that's set up to get the healthcare you already paid for in your premium. And they keep growing and growing that deductible. And here's the crazy thing. Most people don't think they're going to get sick in the next year. And so they don't pay as much attention to that deductible, right? Number two, that's the other problem, is that the cost of healthcare hits you when you least expect it. You think that you're paying for your health insurance and that the operative term in insurance is sure. and it's going to be there for you because you already paid for it. And then you get hit with this deductible, literally adding insult to injury and debt to injury. That's why healthcare accounts for about 67% of all personal bankruptcies in this country. The third problem is that about 10% of our population, because it's so expensive, doesn't have healthcare at all. They cannot get that healthcare that they need except for an emergency room. So they're not getting the regular care that they need and deserve. And if we believe that healthcare is a human right, it is inconsistent for us to continue to allow our healthcare system to bar out 10% of people. And then beyond that, right, we have lack of accessible healthcare, even if you have health insurance, in urban communities and in rural communities. In fact, over the past 10 years, about 120 hospitals have closed in rural communities. And urban communities aren't faring very much better. Instead of closing, those hospitals that were once public and then went to being nonprofit are now being bought up by for-profit hospital chains, and those are being flogged to make as much money for the corporate bottom line as possible, often to the detriment of the quality of care that's being provided. I used to be the health commissioner for the city of Detroit, and while I was at the city, one of our major hospitals that used to be a public hospital got in trouble because they weren't even autoclaving their instruments. And so you see that this is a real issue here. And then lastly, to sort of round it out, and there are many more issues, but the other one I want to hit is that our healthcare system is deeply inequitable. It treats low-income people and Black and brown people worse as a function of both the structural and the upfront biases that are built in the system. And all of that has left our system so that it was liable to collapse in the face of this pandemic. We don't invest in prevention. There is no money made on preventing disease. So we don't invest in public health in our for-profit healthcare system. And so we have not had the infrastructure that we needed to deal with this pandemic appropriately. And then on the back end, because hospitals had to make decisions with respect to whether or not they were going to continue to offer elective procedures, which are their lifeblood in a for-profit healthcare system, and had to shut those down, they were then busy having to battle both the pandemic and bankruptcy at the same time. In fact, in the last year, we saw another 12 hospitals shut down because of COVID-19. And so the system does not provide the quality of care we deserve. It does not provide it equitably, and it does not provide it affordably. We could do so much better if we were willing to rethink that system.
Well, I think that's a great summary. And when we talk about, as my own background is in health financing, when I used to do real work, and just starting with that, it strikes me so strongly that even before the pandemic and the economic hardship it caused, when 70% of the public says that they don't have $1,000 set aside for an emergency, the figure gets to 40% if it's 400 and that kind of thing. But when 70% say they don't have $1,000 set aside, and the typical deductible goes from $1,500 on up, to me, that's a system that is designed to fail as insurance, right? So what I've struggled with, I've been delighted to see that single payer Medicare for All is steadily rising. But in terms of making the case to the public, and I think the media shares some of the blame for this, but I still struggle to understand why more people don't just say to the households of this country, you're spending on average $10,000 a year between, even if you have quote unquote good insurance, on premiums, copays, deductibles, things that aren't covered. How would you like to have that be $4,000 or $3,000 between taxes and anything else incidental? And you never have to worry again about emergency healthcare bills. That to me is a slam dunk. And yet for some reason, our side, for lack of a better term, hasn't made the case, or we've been prevented from making the case. I'm sure your book is a great step in that direction, but why do you think it's been so difficult to get more traction on this?
Well, I'll be honest with you. I think our side's been working really hard, right? Folks like you and so many others have been really pushing the conversation. I've been talking about this since before I ran for office back in 2018. But I'll tell you that there is a lot more money on the other side of the conversation. And You look at the healthcare industry, whether you're talking about the health insurance industry or the pharmaceutical industry or the medical device industry or the hospital industry. These are some of the biggest spenders on advertising dollars in the country and some of the biggest lobbyists in the country. Take pharma, for example. Over the past 20 years, they are the single biggest lobbyist by sector, spending $4.4 billion with a B dollars on lobbying. And so you take them together, and their whole goal has been to crush any sort of reform in healthcare, let alone Medicare for All. There's an organization, and you probably saw their ads if you were watching the primary debates, called the Partnership for America's Healthcare Future. And their whole goal has been to run ads to scare people about Medicare for All. And they tell you that you're going to lose your choice. They tell you that it's going to be too expensive. They tell you that that it's going to cost jobs. And all of these are canards, right? Because when it comes to Medicare for All, we know that number one, it is too expensive to have a $3,500 deductible hanging over a family of four that makes $52,000 a year, right? That's too expensive. And under Medicare for All, what we'd be doing is taking the middleman out of healthcare. We'd be eliminating so much of the profit motive in the health insurance space and reducing the kitchen table budget that people have to spend on their healthcare, right? They tell us that it's going to take away our choice. Well, I'll tell you what, I don't care about the choice of health insurance plan that I have when they're toggling between premiums and deductibles and copays using all kinds of mumbo jumbo that I can't even understand. I care about what choice of doctor I have. And under Medicare for All, you've got one insurer, that's the federal government. You can see any doctor you want. And then they tell you about jobs. Well, here's the thing. 10% of Americans don't have healthcare. And those 10% of Americans who don't have healthcare, that's how many nurses, how many medical assistants, how many doctors that are not working to provide those 10% of Americans healthcare that we would need if we pass Medicare for All. So yes, maybe we won't have as many billers who are charged with taking healthcare away from people, but I'll tell you what, we have a lot more people providing healthcare because we'd have a lot more people who have access to the system who need it. And so, there has been so much money spent trying to confuse the American public about this issue. And frankly, as we talk about in the book, it's not just right now. It has been going on for decades. This is not the first time people have been talking about a national health insurance program or talking about universal healthcare, right? But every single time the conversation comes up, you get these industries reel their head, scaring people about the possibility. And we've got to move beyond it. And as we talk about in the book, what's going to be critical is that the only way to beat their advertising is with our organizing. And so we've got to keep driving the movement for Medicare for All if we're going to win the kind of future where everybody gets access to affordable, accessible, and equitable healthcare.
Well, I agree with everything you've said, and I do know that we're up against powerful forces, and those powerful forces contribute to politicians of both parties. They have, I did a video for Bernie, I guess they have two lobbyists, the healthcare industry, for every member of Congress. In the video, I said, I don't know if one takes a day shift and one takes a night shift, but they are on that. So what do we, your book is going to educate the public because it's a citizen's guide. And I assume the part of educating the public is letting their legislators know often and clearly that they want Medicare for All. Is that a fair statement?
That's right, RJ. It's going to require us, number one, not forgetting that this is possible. I think a lot of folks watched the presidential primary, and when Bernie Sanders didn't win, they felt like, well, you know what? We're just going to have to deal with what we're given. No, we have to remember what we're fighting for. And as Bernie always used to say, it's not me, it's us. And so we have to remember what we're fighting for. That's number one. Number two, yes, being together, thinking about the organizations that you can work with, whether it's the National Nurses United, whether it's Public Citizen, whether it's Social Security Works, whether it's a number of organizations who are leading on this issue on the ground, get involved, right? And that means, yes, reaching out to your congresspeople, reaching out to your senators and telling them that you demand that we engage with Medicare for All, that we pass Medicare for All, that they support Medicare for All, but also, right? It's about furthering the conversation with one another. It's about doing the work of knocking on doors and doing the deep canvassing that changes hearts and minds. And our hope with this book was A, to remind us that this is worth fighting for, and B, to show the way and how important organizing was going to being able to win the future for Medicare for All. This is, I know, right, frustrating that so many people don't have healthcare in the middle of this pandemic. It is devastating in the richest, most powerful country in the world, but we've got to keep working because I believe deeply that in the future, this will be the law of the land and people will not have to worry about whether or not they have health care in the future.
And we've been, and again, we're talking with Dr. Abdul El Sayed about his new book, Medicare for All, A Citizen's Guide. And it's worth remembering that in the last 10 years, we've made enormous strides towards the public embracing this idea. So I don't want anybody listening to be in any way discouraged. Let's see, you mentioned early on in this conversation, pandemic. And it seems to me, you know, as you well know, Pramila Jayapal in the House and Bernie Sanders in the Senate have a bill called the Emergency Healthcare Guarantee Act. Sometimes I mix those words up, but I'm pretty sure I got them right this time. And it basically says anybody who needs medical care of any kind for the duration of the pandemic should not have to pay out of pocket. Now, to me, from a public health perspective, from an economic perspective, from a pandemic management perspective, you're an epidemiologist, it seems to me that's a no-brainer. But the feedback I get from Capitol Hill, is from staffers on Capitol Hill, not rioters, is, well, you know, it's complicated. You know, people don't really understand. To me, it's simple. You get health care because we're in an emergency. And then my attitude would be, once we see how it works, then we fight to make it permanent. But even that is not getting traction. Is that, you think, because a lot of Democrats are just waiting to see what Joe Biden will do? Or is it something where we just have to pressure them more as a movement? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, remember those two lobbyists per member of Congress? Those two lobbyists want to make sure that people who've lost their job and therefore lost their health insurance with their job, that the money that is being spent on providing them health insurance passes through their hands. That's what they want to make sure. And that's why the plans that are being floated that seem to be supported are offering extended COBRA coverage, right? For folks who don't know what COBRA coverage is, it's coverage on your pre-existing health insurance that is continued for you after you lose your job. But COBRA is extremely expensive. And so the plans being floated, right, move money into the pockets of private health insurers to keep them on their plan, to keep people on their plans if they've lost their job. Now, here's the thing, right? You know who's making a ton of money in this pandemic? Not hospitals. You know who's making a ton of money? Insurance. Insurance could just keep people on their insurance if they wanted to, right? They really could. They don't actually need the money. They've been making bumper profits. They, in theory, could just say anybody who has lost their job, right, out of the goodness of our hearts, we're going to keep them on their insurance. But instead, what they've done is employed their army of lobbyists to make sure that we, the people, are now paying them to do the thing they should have done in the first place. And that's why there's opposition to Senator Sanders and Representative Jayapal's bill. And by the way, we're really proud to have both of their forewords on the book because they've been such leading fighters on Medicare for All throughout this past 10 years. And I'm grateful to have their support on the book.
And it's great to hear. And, you know, they are people who talked about this when it was not a popular idea at all. And so we have clearly all of us, our work cut out for us in educating people and the financial benefits that they'll reap, the health benefits they'll reap. And we are up against lobbying efforts that are considerable. Are we doing enough as a movement, you think, to make our presence felt on the Hill? I mean, we can't write the big checks to congressional candidates or whatever, but I would think that if we had people metaphorically during the pandemic, rather than literally knocking on congressional doors, senatorial doors, saying we want to talk to you about why you need to get on board with this, do you think that would make a difference?
Absolutely. Look, the way forward for us isn't going to be with money. The way forward for us is going to be with people power. And the more we have people who are fully and 100% dedicated to engaging with their congresspeople and their senators to get this done, the faster it'll happen. I do want to say something. I know a lot of folks are really frustrated in a moment like this and worked really hard for a candidate who supported Medicare for All and are looking at the outcomes and saying, well, you know, I guess I'm glad that Donald Trump is gone, of course, but I really wanted Medicare for All. There's so much more that we could be doing. And I think what's important to remember in this moment, right, is that the powers that be, the people who are standing in the way of our healthcare, they want us to give up. They want us to think that we cannot win, that it is impossible, and that we should just stay home. And we cannot do that. What we have to be doing is redoubling our efforts, right? Those Aetna and Blue Cross lobbyists, they want us thinking that there is no beating them. And I'll tell you what, that the power of people in a democracy has to matter more than the power of money. And we have to step up and make it so. And so I hope that folks in this moment decide that we're just going to keep coming. We're going to keep redoubling our efforts. We're going to keep talking about this issue and keep advocating for it and keep having conversations with our leaders and our elected officials to make sure that Medicare for All is, in fact, the law of the land. Nobody goes without the health care that they need and that we do not put the profits of corporate CEOs ahead of the well-being of the public.
I think that's extremely well said. And before I let you go, if you have time, I have one more question slash point that I'd love you to address. I may be the only person alive who was both a senior executive in the health insurance industry and then saw the light and reported directly to Bernie Sanders in his first presidential campaign. So from that perspective, I didn't think the Affordable Care Act would work. I thought it would help, you know, some people in some situations, but would have ongoing actuarial and other problems. My sense is that this administration may pass certain measures, but they won't ultimately work. And I'm afraid that if people like us who are in the Medicare for All movement don't frame that correctly, that will work against us. But that if we do frame it correctly, people will come to understand that this is the only path forward that will really work. And I wonder, in closing, if you have any thoughts about that.
A couple. Look, I'm all for getting as many people healthcare as possible. And any plan that's going to expand people's healthcare access is something that I'm going to be for. At the same time, I know the difference between a field goal and a touchdown, right? As a kid who played high school football. And, you know, you want to kick a field goal, fine, but I want to score a touchdown. And I know that if we continue to tinker on the edges of a structurally broken healthcare system as a function of corporations who are hemming us in, that we're never really going to get all the way there. And so, yes, we should be expanding more healthcare to more people. I will always fight for that. But also, let's not say that tinkering around the edges is getting the whole reform. Because really, really, if we're serious about addressing all of the structural failures in our healthcare system, well, you've got to start from the ground up. And that means Medicare for All. So I don't think they're mutually exclusive. I think we can be fighting for more healthcare for more people right now and fighting for Medicare for All as well, even if in this administration we may not get it.
I think that's totally legitimate and fair, as long as we don't wind up with an own goal in the process, which is something I always worry about. But I know you're under time pressure, so I want to leave it there. My guest is Dr. Abdul El Sayed. His latest book coming out next week, you can pre-order it now, is Medicare for All, A Citizen's Guide. And Abdul, thanks for all your great work. Thanks for writing this book, and thanks for coming on The Zero Hour.
RJ, thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure to be with you. And let's go win that fight for Medicare for All.
You got it. And we'll be right back after this. I am Richard, RJ Eskow, and you're listening to The Zero Hour.